We're at the halfway point of the week-long festival and events we'll discuss today coming up. First, I'd like to acknowledge that we are on Wiat land, from which lands the Wiat were dispossessed in the time of settlement. Later, even their tribal status was removed from them. For years, they fought very hard to regain tribal status, which they were able to do in 1991. Since that time, they have recently taken possession of Tulalip, formerly Indian Island. They first purchased a small portion of that, and then in two large grants, they were given the remainder of the island by the city of Eureka. That was the first time that any local, state, or federal government has returned lands to indigenous peoples. We are very proud to be partnering with Barney Atkins of the Wiat Cultural Center through part of this festival. For the Wiat people and for many other indigenous peoples, land is not something to be exploited and owned. Rather, it's to be honored and treasured, given to you by the Creator and then cared for by you and your ancestors. That's the relationship of indigenous peoples in our community to the land that we now occupy. I'd like to say a few words about us and how this group came to be called Which Way the Wind. So in 2010, a wooden boat sinks at a ferry. When Leroy Zerline pulls that boat onto the beach and tries to look and see what this is all about, he discovers that it's the Golden Rule. The Golden Rule is a very historic boat. It was the first anti-nuclear peace boat in the world. And in 1958, Albert Bigelow, with a crew of three Quaker volunteers, attempted to sail from San Pedro Harbor in Southern California into the Marshall Islands to protest above-ground nuclear testing, which was being carried out in the United States, and to alert the world to the dangers posed by such testing. They never did get to the Marshall Islands. On two attempts to get out of Honolulu Harbor, they were stopped by the Coast Guard, once in international waters. They were arrested on both occasions. They were jailed on both occasions. They were convicted in court on both occasions, and then sentenced on the second occasion to jail time. That sentence was reduced and they were released to return, I think on the condition that they stopped doing what they were doing and returned to the United States. Later in 1958, to continue the anti-nuclear activism and pick up on the publicity that they had gotten, Albert Bigelow, working with the Quakers, commissioned a play, an anti-war, anti-nuclear play to be written. That play was called Which Way the Wind. That's where we get our name. And that name of that play comes from lines in the play. In the latter part of the play, there's a hearing going on in the Senate, and a senator asks a general who's testifying, he says, "Well, General, tell me what would happen in terms of deaths if a nuclear bomb was released over a major American city." And the general, after a pause, says, "Well, Senator, that depends on which way the wind." So that's where that whole story began. Between 2010, when that boat sunk, and 2015, the local chapters from Garberville and Humboldt Bay of the Veterans of Peace carefully and lovingly restored that boat with a number of other volunteers, and in 2015, relaunched that boat into Humboldt Bay, which remains its home port. Currently, that boat is in the Mississippi, traveling from town to town, still preaching its anti-nuclear peace mission. The Which Way the Wind Festival began in 2018. At that time, we had the purpose of really raising money to support the mission of the Golden Rule. Since that time, the organization festival has begun to address a little bit of a larger area, the nexus between nuclear proliferation, global climate change, and environmental degradation. We are a 501c3 nonprofit corporation, nonprofit fund, organized under the Humboldt Area Foundation, and welcome donations for support. We have been inspired by the Boat Golden Rule and the Golden Rule Principle, upon which a just, moral, and equitable society is based. It's our mission to engage the Humboldt community through the arts, to advocate and support efforts for peace and to increase awareness of the perils and costs of nuclear weapons and global climate threats. We will continue our, just briefly talk about what's coming up in the week ahead and a few days. Tomorrow night, we will have a program that we're calling Burlesque Comedy and Song, Which Way to Win Cabaret, an Evening of Humor, Song, and Burlesque, Examining the Absurdities of War and the Nuclear Deterrence Strategies. Thursday, our panel will be talking about issues specifically on Humboldt Bay, Humboldt Bay opportunities and challenges. We're going to look at the issues of 3 feet of sea level rise, the effect on communities surrounding the bay, and then the storage of the nuclear fuel rods at Booner Point, 44 feet above sea level. Friday night is poetry night, musings, the passing the sea beyond the visible, hosted by Jeff DeMarc and featuring local poets. And on Saturday night, a evening of music, curated by Jim Hubbard, and featuring local musicians. All the winners of the songwriting contest will be performing their work on that night. We also had an art contest, which we conducted. You see the results of the art contest hanging on the walls. All that art will remain at Synapse through the festival and probably up until mid-November. It's then going to move to the Ribbon Art Association for a month, and we will be hosting a reception for the artists on Arts Alive on December the 3rd, first Saturday. That's my spiel. Now I'd like to bring to the microphone Anne Fricke. Anne is a local poet, author, mom, wife, resident of Humboldt County. She also has a podcast supporting parents and children with special needs to help bring those people together and look for answers and solutions. And I've asked Anne to sort of set up the night with her poem. Anne, please greet her. Thank you.
Thank you. I want to say it's an honor to be here. I have two poems. We'll get right into it. So this first one, 20 years ago, I gathered with a group of young people at the Arcata Peace and Justice Center, that was when that existed, to plan a trip to the Nevada test site to protest the dumping of nuclear waste on Yucca Mountain. When it was time, we all piled into a school bus run on biodiesel called the Sustainable Communities Biodiesel Roadshow. When we rode out to the lands of the Western Shoshone, where we camped for 3 days near the entrance to the Nevada test site. It was an incredible 3 days of protests, speakers, action, ceremony, and a life-changing experience. And while I was there, I wrote this first poem. And when I got asked to do this poem here, I wanted to edit it because I went back and read it and was like, oh, wow, I was 22 when I wrote that. And my ego wanted me to edit it, but I just think it needs to be said this way. So then I wrote a second poem, which I'll read after this, which is, I'll tell you more about that. So this is, was written by a 22-year-old, impassioned college student. She's leaving the Nevada test site, and the title is Truth is God, which most of you know is probably know that Gandhi said that, but I learned about it from a band called Klandaiken, and I'm pretty sure they were at the Nevada test site with this. I don't know why I think that, but and they had a song. That's where I learned it. Beautiful desert mother, the sun casts shadows upon her, watching as she nurtures the cacti and lizards, welcomes the native people, holds the new way in their mourning. Our tears dampen the dust of cancer, her body contaminated by radiation, suffocation, conflagration, breasts pummeled for the fascination of death machines. Visions of domination and wealth of their imagination extracted by the torture and rape of our mother. So rage. Rage to the lion, but don't stop there. Step across to her womb, her battered and sterilized ovaries. Step across to shed your tears and open your arms, but don't stop there. Rage to the schools, rage to the offices, rage to the government, rage to the world, rage to the death. And with this rage, bring love. Love for those who have been victimized by colonial oppressors, by greed, by genocide, by hate. And love to those victimized by apathy and ignorance, intolerance, and fear. Perhaps they need our prayers the most. But with love and true knowledge, they will cross the line to our side and see. See, there are no sides to choose, no lines to cross, no reason to destroy. See, there is no method to this destruction, this death by construction of our need for consumption and wealth of abstraction. With love and true knowledge, they will hold our hands in celebration of the sunrise, shuffle their feet with the beat of our mother, our lives, our souls. They will witness every prayer, every creation of the divine. They will finally understand the words of our brother Gandhi and see the truth. So I wanted to, I wrote a new poem for this. I wrote this a few weeks ago, and this is a reflection on that time, but written as a now a 43-year-old mother of three daughters who has witnessed society for the last two decades. and so I brought, I've never had a visual aid for a poem before, but I managed to find this in my barn. So as we were planning the Peace and Justice Center 20 years ago, there was, we knew there was going to be an auction, a way to raise money for the Shoshone. And so we were coming up with ideas, and I had just made my first quilt. It was very poorly made, and I had a box of fabric that my mom had sent me. So I said, why don't we make a quilt? So being a poor college student, I went to the thrift store, and I got two sheets, and I sewed them together with batting in the middle. When I got loaded onto the bus, I brought my fabric, and we, on our way to the desert, we all sat around this quilt, and we all sewed patches onto the quilt, which to represent our prayers and our blessings and what we hold valuable in this world. And at the Nevada test site, it auctioned off for almost $200, which at the time and with that group of people was an impressive amount of money. And so I went home with somebody and I never saw it again. And but somebody made a picture. This is us holding the quilt, and I can pass it around while I'm reading the poem. Right there in the middle, when you get to it, you can see that it, that's Yucca Mountain, right in the middle, and it says, Love Mother Earth, in cute quilted letters. So.
Do you want to pass the net?
Yes, thank you.
So I also wanted to say that, also we got to, while we were there, the Shoshone invited us to participate in ceremony. And so we did sweat lodges at night. And in the morning, we did the sunrise ceremony every morning. And Corbin Harney was still alive then. He was the spiritual leader of the Western Shoshone. And I consider it one of my greatest honors that I was able to attend that and be with him in that moment. So this poem is titled A Reflection. Sometimes I think of the quilt, on whose wall our prayers and well wishes hang. Broken thread and frayed edges, the handwork of young adults with few soured hopes or bitter failings, our trust in society not yet chipped away to a pinpoint of piercing jade. Has the quilt withstood these last few decades, proudly displayed in the warmth of someone's living room, or stuffed into a box, hand-stitched sunbeams unraveling in the dark and dusty corners of a forgotten attic? I think on that time, of revolutionary agendas, the passion of inspired youth crossing the line, the chain-link view from the holding pen, the native people who entrusted us with their stories, the tales of broken histories and poisoned futures, and a place to lay our heads. The world has continued to turn, and I have turned to new battles, but not before lodging the lessons of that moment into the space between my bones. Wrap the ceremony around my DNA, bathe my essence in the glory of a desert sunrise. I can still feel the call to prayer. The steady drumbeat permeating my nylon cocoon, I curled around myself under the vastness of a sparkling desert sky, emerging from the chill of cheap camping gear to the cold bite of star-kissed air. Lacing boots with shaking hands, wading through the dark towards the drumbeat, a heartbeat, a flame pulling us into its orbit, the circle of people growing as hands link hands, our feet stepping in time to the beat, circling the flame, always moving, watching the blackened hills come alive with hues of purple and pink, sunlight gliding along the surface like the hands of a lover. The simultaneous rising of reverence within our sphere, filling us with the courage to face the fight, raise our voices over the clatter of humanity's destruction while our feet stay grounded in the simplicity of welcoming the sun. In that moment, I was shown that even in the midst of darkness, atrocities centuries deep, horrors generations long, theft of land and family, even as poison courses through veins, we must rise in the darkness, stumble our way to the ember on the horizon, bow our hopes to the growing illumination as we pray, dance, and sing that light into being. And no matter how tattered the edges, no matter how worn and faded the fabric, we must always hang our hopes and prayers in the living spaces of our hearts as reminders of what it is we fight for.
Thank you so much, Anne. That's a perfect setting of tone for the evening. It ends on optimism despite what the world's stage instead set is at the moment. Thank you very much. I'd like to now begin to welcome the panel up to the stage. We have a very distinguished group of people on the panel tonight. Patrice Sutton will be moderating the panel. Patrice has almost 40 years of experience in the health field, health policy, community development, and a variety of other health-related activities. She's part of the Physicians for Social Responsibility in the Bay Area as well, and has authored articles and books. She will be the moderator, as I said. Bob Gould is a physician and has been the head of the San Francisco Bay Area Physicians for Social Responsibility for over 30 years. He's a past president of the Physicians for Social Responsibility in the U.S. He's a tireless worker in the area of peace, justice, disarmament, nuclear policy, lectures throughout the world and across the United States. Jackie Cabasso is joining us. She's the executive director of the Western States Legal Foundation. 40 years of activism in the anti-nuclear peace promoting field. She just has returned from a month in New York at the UN Nuclear Proliferation Treaty Conference, and we'll possibly have an opportunity to talk about the outcome of that. She spoke at that conference. She has received a number of awards for her peace activities, has authored books and many articles as well. And we also have a local expert, and that's Dale Preston. Dale is an expert on the effects of ionizing, especially ionizing radiation. He's worked with the survivors of Hiroshima and Nagasaki for over 30 years. He's been a consultant in Japan, been consulting in Russia for nuclear disasters and how to manage those, how to deal with them. Please welcome our panel to the stage.
We have a fantastic panel that's going to be speaking, and we're going to bookmark or bookend, I guess, their presentations with two short PSAs. The first one's about a minute and a half, and the last one after Dale speaks is about 3 minutes. And there'll be kind of a before and after to think about. And we'll show those first. The way it's going to run is each of the speakers is going to talk for about 15 minutes, and then there's going to be a break. And then we'll have a lot of time to engage with you after the break with Q&A.
So there's been a nuclear attack. Don't ask me how or why, just know that the big one has hit, okay? So, what do we do? There are three important steps that I want you to remember. Step one, get inside fast. You, your friends, your family, get inside. And no, staying in the car is not an option. You need to get into a building and move away from the windows. Step two, stay inside. Shut all doors and windows. Have a basement? Head there. If you don't have one, get as far into the middle of the building as possible. If you were outside after the blast, get clean immediately. Remove and bag all outer clothing to keep radioactive dust or ash away from your body. Step 3, stay tuned. Follow media for more information. Don't forget to sign up for Notify NYC for official alerts and updates. And don't go outside until officials say it's safe. All right, you've got this.
So now you'll all be prepared to be in New York City for a nuclear attack.
Hi, everyone, and it's a real honor to be here once again and to take part in this festival that I've had the real honor to be speaking to this wonderful community that both Patrice and I have really developed wonderful friendships in. So I'm here, as Jack indicated, speaking for Physicians for Social Responsibility. And as this slide indicates, we work to protect human life from the gravest threats to health and survival. And we won the Nobel, shared the Nobel Peace Prize in 1985 with the International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War. At that time, dealing with the really grave situation with the then Soviet Union, which unfortunately we're seeing the sequelae now in terms of our current context. So in marked contrast to the insurances that were there in the New York City PSA, we actually face really significant dangers right now, as even President Biden indicated a few days ago in the New York Times, in terms of in this week where we're remembering the 60th anniversary of the Cuban Missile Crisis, the real grievous nuclear dangers that we're facing. And as the New York Times opined not too long ago, the world can still be destroyed in a flash, as we well recognize with the what we remember close to our hearts, the terrible twin bombings in Hiroshima and Nagasaki that by the end of 1945 took the lives of over 210,000 human beings by the combined impacts of heat, blast, and radiation. And much of the knowledge that we had from the suffering of the Japanese people from those combined impacts went into what became the PSR bombing runs for the last half a century. And in contrast to the assurances that you got that from the New York City Department of Emergency Preparedness, this is more like what I recall, and I'm sure many of you, in the duck and cover times of the 1950s and 1960s, where we would get under the desk and some people would say, kiss our asses goodbye. This prompted a worldwide anti-nuclear movement from the 1950s through the present, a campaign for nuclear disarmament. In the prior slide, this is when, and I think I showed this a few years ago, where hundreds of members of the American Public Health Association gathered at the Nevada test site, the site of testing nuclear weapons, to protest nuclear weapons at the time that APHA was located in Las Vegas. And of course, this is all framed as well by the incredible contributions of the people who sailed the Golden Rule and the next years of people protesting nuclear weapons in the Pacific. And it was such an honor, again, to have been here for that 2015 launching of the Golden Rule. Now we're facing a situation where this is the nuclear threats worldwide. There are a total of over 13,000 nuclear weapons, over 90% of them held by the United States and Russia. But as you go down even on the other nuclear powers, which might be harder for you to read, even the case of Pakistan and India, which themselves have less than 300 nuclear warheads between them, can give a situation such as this. This slide and the next one are slides from Dr. Chawla of the Indian Doctors for Peace and Development, who kindly gave me these slides about 20 years ago, which indicated that even a nuclear exchange of 50 Hiroshima-sized weapons on either side could lead to anywhere from 16 to 20 million deaths. But what we have learned over the last two decades is that not only does that have regional impacts with that much death and destruction, but global impacts in terms of giving us new information on what Carl Sagan 50 years ago modeled with nuclear winter. Doctors Robach and Toon, this being about 10 years ago, have looked at what are the impacts of even a regional nuclear war, an exchange between India and Pakistan, would have on global food supplies, next slide, whereby in a regional nuclear war, the incineration of cities on either side of a nuclear exchange like that would lead to such the burning and incineration of cities leading to so much soot that you would block out sunlight, although ultraviolet radiation could still get through with its carcinogenic effects, whereby you'd have a massive fall in worldwide corn, wheat, and rice production with an estimated 2 billion people at the risk of severe malnutrition as a result of that. Because of that, we engage with many partners such as Jackie, Global Abolition 2000, Mayors for Peace, for a major campaign about the humanitarian impact of nuclear weapons. And we in PSR, as part of our division of labor within this movement, in particular try to organize among physicians and other health professionals, whereby the AMA and World Medical Association supported the efforts for nuclear abolition. And all of this culminated in a major popular movement, a real global movement to prohibit nuclear weapons, and went outside of the limited process of the non-proliferation treaty that Jackie will talk more in detail about the travails there, whereas you could see in 2017, 122 nations voted in favor of this treaty to prohibit nuclear weapons. And for this effort, the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons won the Nobel Peace Prize in 2017. And as of the UN meetings within the last 2 months, there are now over 90 nations who have signed this treaty, and 68 have ratified it to put it into force as a global treaty. However, the main problem has been, though, this is clearly the global will to prohibit nuclear weapons because of their intense danger. The nuclear weapon state remain in opposition to this process, and this is despite the fact that, for example, and this opposition started within the Obama administration, despite the fact that there was so much promise when President Obama became president and gave his famous speech in Prague in 2009 calling for a world without nuclear weapons. Nonetheless, even under the Obama administration, was revving up a nuclear weapons modernization project that would cost anywhere from $1.2 to $2 trillion over the course of the three decades from the time it was instituted, which is anywhere from $4 to $6 million every hour to spend on these weapons of mass destruction. Clearly, stuff that could better go to deal with climate change, to deal with our health crisis, et cetera. And we saw, building upon this nuclear modernization, that under the Trump administration, we had an accelerated effort to continue to modernize our weapon systems, aimed, as this official said, to spend Russia, China into oblivion to win a nuclear arms race. And in fact, some of the key treaties, for example, the INF, the International Nuclear Forces Treaty, that was a major victory when Gorbachev and Reagan met and helped cool out the tensions and led to the end of the Cold War. We've even upended that treaty because of our desire to counter Russia and particularly China as a rising power. And to date, although we're focused certainly in many ways on the imminent dangers coming out of the Ukraine, we continue to fuel the fires in our confrontation with China. Speaker Pelosi's visit to Taiwan a few months ago, and as this New York Times article indicates, we're conceiving of stuffing Taiwan with arms, which could lead to another flashpoint for nuclear war. Of course, as this op-ed that came from two of our PSR leaders in the San Francisco Chronicle a few months ago have really focused on the intense dangers that our speakers will also be addressing on how a nuclear disaster in Ukraine can bring a war to our doorsteps at a moment's notice, not just from the confrontation as we normally think about a nuclear weapons exchange, but also the increasing dangers of nuclear power facilities in areas of warfare, as we've seen with the intense dangers of the Zaporizhzhia facilities and other nuclear power facilities that are in the fire zone. And as well, returning, of course, to the dangers of a nuclear exchange, we have said that the headline is clipped off here, but that we would, if the Russians indeed follow through with many of their recent nuclear threats in the wake and supporting their brutal invasion of Ukraine, this would have catastrophic effects in terms of what U.S. or NATO response could be. And a lot of this has to do, this map, again, it's well clipped off, apologize for it. This map indicates nuclear weapon stores, a lot of tactical weapons that are in the European zone that could be brought into play if there is a conflict that goes nuclear. Next slide. And although this is, can't see the headline here, I apologize, but it's the headline is indicating this is from some of our PSR leaders in op-ed as well, to say that both NATO and Russia really need to cool out the situation if we're going to get out of this without having a nuclear exchange. More recently, we had an updated version of addressing the issues of nuclear famine that were written by one of our board members, Matt Bivens, on behalf of IPPNW. And this gave new models to what would be the dangers of an exchange between Pakistan and India on the left, going beyond the scenarios of 50 nuclear weapons apiece. But we also, for the first time within this report, actually examined what the consequences would be of what could be a likely nuclear exchange if things really get out of hand between the United States and Russia, where the estimate is that 5 billion out of 6.7 people living worldwide could be dead within 2 years from an accelerated, accelerated result of the famine, from even more sunlight being blocked out and the consequences for food production. As a result of this, we've redoubled our efforts for a campaign that we started a number of years ago, the Back from the Brink campaign. And this has a number of major points that we've been utilizing as a framework for engaging municipalities and communities around the country. The major points are renouncing the options of using nuclear weapons first, which has come up certainly in the current crisis. Ending the sole unchecked authority of any U.S. president, not only Trump, but any other president, to launch a nuclear attack. Taking U.S. nuclear weapons off hair trigger alert, which could, within 15 minutes, plunge the world into a nuclear apocalypse. Canceling the plan to replace the entire nuclear arsenal with enhanced weapons that anywhere up to $2 trillion over 30 years type of budgeting, and to actively pursue a verifiable agreement among nuclear-armed states to eliminate their nuclear arsenals. This could be a model, could be a nuclear weapons convention, or it could be an enforced treaty to prohibit nuclear weapons. And in, next slide, please. We had success in 2018 in getting such a resolution passed by the San Francisco Board of Supes. Soon after that followed a joint declaration of both the California Assembly and the Senate. And right here in this hometown, and I want to congratulate the organizers here for your successful resolution in both the Eureka and Arcata City Councils for Back from the Brink. This was also uptake by the U.S. Conference of Mayors. Again, want to thank Jackie for her incredible work with Mayors for Peace in engaging the U.S. Conference of Mayors. and also which took a significant stand against the military budgets that are upending their ability to serve their people. In the American Public Health Association, with both Patrice and I work within the APHA Peace Caucus, this is the oldest and largest public health association in the world, adopted a resolution also embracing all of the planks of the Back from the Brink campaign in 2020. And more recently, we've been grappling with the political issues that we need to face in terms of we're doing these resolutions and many supportive municipalities around the country, but there's a real need to go beyond our choir, if you will, in terms of moving these issues forward, and a real need to integrate this within the larger movement for democracy that's under attack now with the attack on elections, etc., but also the broader need to build an active social movement that deals with the people who are really cut out, particularly enhanced by the experiences under COVID, in terms of being able to have health care, to be able to have, you know, a basic income to live on, and the incredible environmental injustice and racism that still exists in many of the communities that we want to bring into a broad anti-militarism peace movement, but one that serves social justice next line. All of this gets back to a warning that President Eisenhower gave about the military arms race. Every gun that is made, every rocket fired, signifies in the final sense a theft for those who hunger and are not fed, those who are cold and are not clothed. And this has been certainly something that we have to look at in the last two decades, for example, of the quote-unquote wars on terror, that we spent $21 trillion over the last 20 years, according to this report from the Institute for Policy Studies. The Director General of the World Health Organization earlier this year linked together the issues of war and peace and our climate crisis, as well as our ability as a globe to deal with the COVID crisis in a really thoughtful way. And this graphic illustrates some of the trade-offs, even in terms of just COVID, where $35 billion a year, which is really only half of our total budgeting for nuclear weapons, because it's not just that for the warheads, but an equivalent amount for the delivery systems. Half of that total amount could provide 300,000 beds in intensive care, 35,000 ventilators, 150,000 nurses, and 75,000 doctors, just to give an illustration of what those trade-offs could be. On another way, looking at total health care costs, the $740 billion we as taxpayers paid the military last year could have provided close to 150 million adults with low-income health care for 1 year. Not the best health care, but fundamental health care, or close to 258 million children the same. The other things we need to think of are, like, what are we not spending for our climate crisis? The U.S. spends 28 times as much on traditional concepts of military security as opposed to climate security. And the one thing that we have to think about is the enormous military footprint of climate footprint of our military. Next slide. And the Cost of War Project of Brown University put out this graphic, for example, over 1 billion metric tons of greenhouse gases that have been put out by the military since the dawn of the wars on terror. This is the larger institutional contributor to our global climate crisis. There have been attempts by many people who have been heroes for us, Barbara Lee and Representative Mark Pocan, who have over the years tried to cut our military budget, not as much as we really should, just to cut it 10% some years, to cut it by $100 billion, and as well the work of Representative Jayapal to connect this with what the Reverend William Barber of the Poor People's Campaign and the Poor People's Campaign has put out as the moral budget, in terms of being able to connect it. Barbara Lee and Jayapal, for example, introduced the third Reconstruction resolution within Congress to link the impacts of the military budget on the health care that people aren't receiving, to deal with the fact that we have 140 million hungry people in our country that we could instead use these military budgets for, which Dale will be getting into in much more detail. In this sense, and in wrapping up, want to really think and take to heart the important words that Reverend Martin Luther King had for us when he was linking the impacts of the Vietnam War and the civil rights movement back in his famous speech at Riverside Church in 1967, a nation that continues year after year to spend more money on military defense than on programs of social uplift is approaching spiritual death. In line with this, many people this very week, and again, in commemoration of the 60th anniversary of the Cuban Missile Crisis, who are working with the defusenuclearwar.org coalition that Jackie and my organization belong to, Veterans for Peace as well, having actions on the 14th and on the 16th, picket signs in front of various congressional offices, many in California as well, that are calling for support of many of the same planks of the Back from the Brink resolutions, as well as to make sure that our congressional people should really speak up on this time, not just be approving military budgets willy-nilly because of the very grievous situation in the Ukraine, but the fact that we really need to put some conditions, be able to have a really strong negotiating position to keep this from spiraling out of control. And in line with this as well, and bringing it back to this community and the issue of the Golden Rule, and Jackie's been working with through Mayors for Peace, and this is a proclamation that will be put out tomorrow by Mayor County of Mayors for Peace of Des Moines, Iowa. It's a proclamation welcoming Veterans for Peace who are on the Mississippi River and in Des Moines and honoring their efforts to end the nuclear weapons catastrophe that we're in, and to support all of these planks that Veterans for Peace is nobly sailing around and trying to get the word on. So I'll end it with that. All of these steps are really at the heart of what we've been trying to fight for decades, that there's no cure, only prevention for nuclear war, that all of our efforts have to go in and to build the movement that we can really make a change here. So thanks for your time. Again, it's a real honor to speak to all of you.
Possible. Bob, and our next speaker is Jackie Cabasso with Western States Legal Foundation.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Can you hear me okay? Okay, thank you again. Thank you, Bob. That was a great setup. It's a pleasure for me to be here as well, and I'm happy to report that I was able to successfully navigate both the fog at both San Francisco Airport and Eureka Airport, although it took a couple of days to get here, but I made it. So in the 1980s, the palpable fear of nuclear war between the U.S. and the Soviet Union was at the top of most people's minds in the U.S. and around the world. Yet following the end of the Cold War, nuclear weapons fell off the public's radar screen. It was almost as if the planet itself breathed a sigh of relief. People around the world hoped and believed that they had escaped a nuclear holocaust and largely put nuclear weapons out of their minds. Most people believed that the threat of nuclear war had ended, but it hadn't. Deeply embedded in the U.S. military-industrial complex, military planners and scientists at the nuclear weapons labs conjured up new justifications to sustain the nuclear weapons enterprise. In 1991, Colin Powell, then chair of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, following the collapse of the Soviet Union, declared, quote, "We no longer have the luxury of having a specific threat to plan for. What we plan for is that we're a superpower, we're the major player on the world stage with responsibilities and interests around the world." In fact, U.S. national security policy has been remarkably consistent in the post-World War II and post-Cold War eras, despite dramatically changed geopolitical conditions and very different presidential styles, to say the least. Deterrence, the threatened use of nuclear weapons, has been reaffirmed as the cornerstone of U.S. national security policy by every president, Democrat or Republican, including Obama, since 1945, when President Harry Truman, a Democrat, oversaw the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Russia and other would-be superpowers have increasingly modeled their own national security policies and their economies on the U.S. model. In fact, nuclear weapons are already being used by Russia, the U.S., and NATO to provide top cover for their conventional military operations. In February of last year, Admiral Charles Richard, head of U.S. Strategic Command, in charge of nuclear war planning, wrote, quote, "We must acknowledge the foundational nature of our nation's strategic nuclear forces as they create the maneuver space for us to project conventional military power strategically," end quote. We're clearly seeing this concept being played out by Russia in the Ukraine. Richard also warned, quote, "There's a real possibility that a regional crisis with Russia or China could escalate quickly to a conflict involving nuclear weapons if they perceived a conventional loss would threaten the regime or state." We're living in a time of extraordinary nuclear dangers. All of the nuclear-armed states are modernizing their nuclear arsenals. With Russia's illegal war of aggression on Ukraine, which could eventually draw the militaries of the U.S., its NATO allies, and Russia into direct conflict, exacerbated by Russia's repeated threats to use nuclear weapons, the specter of nuclear war has risen to its highest level since the 1962 Cuban Missile Crisis. Other festering nuclear flashpoints include Taiwan, the Korean Peninsula, South Asia, and the Middle East. The scale and tempo of war games by nuclear-armed states and their allies, including nuclear drills, are increasing. Ongoing missile tests and frequent close encounters between military forces of nuclear-armed states exacerbate nuclear dangers. While our nuclear worries have mainly been focused on Russia of late, on October 9th, just a few days ago, North Korea fired two ballistic missiles, the seventh such launch since September 25th. According to North Korea's state news agency, KCNA, the recent flurry of missile tests was designed to simulate showering South Korea with tactical nuclear weapons as a warning. And this was done in response to large-scale Navy drills by South Korean and U.S. forces. KCNA reported that the various tests simulated targeting military command facilities, striking main ports, and neutralizing airports in the south to deliver a strong message of war deterrence. The North Korean Ministry of Defense also warned that the U.S. recent deployment of the aircraft carrier Ronald Reagan near the Korean Peninsula is causing a, quote, "considerably huge negative splash," end quote, in regional security, and it defended its recent missile tests as a, quote, "righteous reaction," end quote, to intimidating military drills between its rivals. So these are some of the dynamics that are at play, the geopolitical dynamics. The Russian leadership's latest nuclear threats have raised public anxiety about the possibility of nuclear war. But in reality, we've been living under the shadow of the mushroom cloud continuously since 1945. In 1982, at the height of the Cold War, Swedish Prime Minister Olof Palme's Independent Commission on Disarmament and Security Issues published a report which introduced the concept of common security, the notion that nations and peoples can only feel safe when their counterparts feel safe. To mark the 40th anniversary of this landmark report, the Olof Palme International Center, International Peace Bureau, and International Trade Union Confederation issued a new report called Common Security 2022 for Our Shared Future. It begins, quote, "The world stands at a crossroads, faced with a choice between an existence based on confrontation and aggression, or one to be rooted in a transformative peace agenda and common security. In 2022, humanity faces the existential threats of nuclear war, climate change, and pandemics. This is compounded by a toxic mix of inequality, extremism, nationalism, gender violence, and shrinking democratic space. How humanity responds to these threats will decide our very survival," end quote. It's against this backdrop that the first meeting of states parties to the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, or TPNW, and the 10th Review Conference of the Nuclear Nonproliferation Treaty, or NPT, took place this summer. The NPT represents the only binding commitment in a multilateral treaty to the goal of disarmament by the five original nuclear-armed states, the U.S., the U.K., the USSR, and its successor Russia, France, and China. In Article 6, all states, including the nuclear-armed states, pledged, quote, to pursue negotiations in good faith on effective measures relating to cessation of the nuclear arms race at an early date and to nuclear disarmament, end quote. In Articles 1 and 2, non-nuclear-armed states pledged not to acquire nuclear weapons or transfer them to other states. As an incentive not to acquire nuclear weapons, in Article 4, the non-nuclear-armed states were promised, quote, an inalienable right to peaceful nuclear technology and assistance with research, production, and use of nuclear energy for peaceful purposes, quote, without discrimination. Excuse me, but this seems to be falling down and sinking lower and lower. It's kind of like... Thank you. Oop. Okay, thank you. And the NPT was signed in 1968 and entered into force in 1970. Its initial duration was 25 years. In 1995, the treaty was extended indefinitely with a review conference to be held every 5 years. Nearly every country in the world, 191 in all, is a party to the NPT, with only four exceptions: India, Israel, and Pakistan, which are all nuclear-armed states now, and South Sudan. North Korea, now nuclear-armed, withdrew in 2003, but its withdrawal is not recognized by the NPT states' parties. The NPT's disarmament obligations enshrined in the preamble in Article 6 have been reiterated and reinforced by agreements made in connection with the 1995 extension decision, the 2000 and 2010 review conferences, and the International Court of Justice's 1996 advisory opinion, which provided the authoritative interpretation of Article 6. The court found unanimously, quote, there exists an obligation to pursue in good faith and bring to a conclusion negotiation leading to nuclear disarmament in all its aspects under strict and effective international control, end quote. Consensus broke down in the 2005 and 2015 NPT review conferences, and they were unable to produce final outcome agreements due to the failure of the nuclear-armed states to make good on their disarmament obligations. The failure of the 2015 NPT review conference also provided impetus for negotiation of the TPNW at UN headquarters in New York in 2017. The treaty entered into force on January 22, 2021, framed in terms of deep concern about the catastrophic humanitarian consequences that would result from any nuclear weapons use. The TPNW prohibits states' parties from developing, testing, producing, manufacturing, transferring, possessing, stockpiling, using, or threatening to use nuclear weapons, or allowing nuclear weapons to be stationed on their territory, and prohibits them from assisting, encouraging, or inducing anyone to engage in any of these activities. The TPNW also requires state parties to provide assistance to victims of nuclear use or testing under its jurisdiction, and to undertake environmental remediation of areas under its jurisdiction contaminated by testing or the use of nuclear weapons. The first meeting of the TPNW states parties took place in Vienna, Austria, in June of this year, where they adopted the Vienna Declaration and the 50-point Vienna Action Plan. There are currently 91 signatories and 68 states parties to the treaty. While all of them are non-nuclear armed states parties to the NPT, the TPNW is binding only on those states which have signed and ratified it. In the Vienna Declaration, states parties expressed their alarm and dismay at threats to use nuclear weapons and condemned unequivocally quote any and all nuclear threats, whether they be explicit or implicit, and irrespective of circumstances, end quote. Affirming that the TPNW is needed more than ever in these circumstances, the state's party's resolve to, quote, move forward with its implementation with the aim of further stigmatizing and delegitimizing nuclear weapons and steadily building a robust global peremptory norm against them, end quote. They also reaffirmed the complementarity of the treaty with the NPT, and undertook to contribute to support the NPT and all measures that can effectively contribute to nuclear disarmament. While the state's parties to the TPNW feel that negotiating the treaty was a good faith effort to implement Article 6 of the NPT, the nuclear-armed states' parties to the NPT are hostile to the TPNW, asserting that it undermines the NPT. Since no nuclear-armed state or state under a nuclear umbrella has joined the TPNW, it is not yet a disarmament treaty. I find it somewhat ironic that the only concrete obligation the state's parties to the TPNW can undertake at this point is victim assistance and environmental remediation resulting from nuclear use and testing that they were not responsible for. At the close of the month-long NPT review conference on August 26th of this year, states' parties meeting at the UN in New York were unable to agree on the text of a final document. While the proximate cause was Russia's refusal to accept language about its military occupation of the Zaporizhia nuclear power plant in Ukraine, it was clear that many governments were dissatisfied with the draft final document, feeling that it was weak and lacking benchmarks, timelines, and measurable goals for nuclear disarmament. While the nuclear-armed states had apparently been willing to accept vague recommitments to previous obligations in the draft final document, they were not willing to commit to any concrete pathway to get there. In the draft document, the four other nuclear-armed states must have known that Russia would block. This can only be viewed as the epitome of bad faith during a four-week festival of double standards, hypocrisy, and outright lying by the nuclear-armed states. As Ambassador Kmet said on behalf of Austria, quote, we hope that a deeply unsatisfactory review of this review conference will serve as a wake-up call. Austria will not tire in our work to implement the NPT and the TPNW. We have no other choice given the existential dangers and risks of nuclear weapons, end quote. In 1946, Lewis Mumford wrote, quote, you cannot talk like sane men around a peace table while the atomic bomb itself is ticking beneath it. Do not treat the atomic bomb as a weapon of offense. Do not treat it as an instrument of the police. Treat the bomb for what it is, the visible insanity of a civilization that has ceased to worship life and obey the laws of life, end quote. Sitting in the basement of the United Nations for 4 weeks, observing the NPT sessions that were open to civil society was literally like watching mad, mostly men, around what's supposed to be a peace table, now with the hydrogen bomb ticking beneath it. The failure of the 2022 NPT review conference due to the intransigence of the nuclear-armed states in the face of new arms racing, the long-term viability of the NPT is being questioned by some. An aspect of this review conference deserving greater scrutiny was the hyperbolic promotion of, quote, peaceful uses of nuclear technology by the International Atomic Energy Agency and most of the state's parties, nuclear armed and nuclear weapon free. As I said, Article 4 of the NPT confers upon all states' parties an inalienable right to peaceful nuclear technology. The draft final document, which was not adopted, states, quote, the conference underlines that IAEA activities in the field of technical cooperation and nuclear applications contribute in an important way to meeting energy needs, improving human and animal health, combating poverty, protecting the environment, developing agriculture, managing the use of water resources, optimizing industrial processes, and preserving cultural heritage, thus helping to improve the quality of life and the well-being of the peoples of the world, end quote. In contrast to the lack of measures to advance nuclear disarmament going forward, the draft final document included a long list of specific activities to further promote and expand peaceful uses of nuclear technology. Listening to the government's statements and reading their working papers, one might be led to believe that nuclear energy will solve all of the world's problems. Yet most, if not all, nuclear technology is inherently dual use, meaning it has the potential to be weaponized. Against the background of ongoing proliferation concerns and palpable alarm about growing dangers at Zaporizhzhia, no one questioned the wisdom of re-legitimizing and reinvesting in so-called peaceful nuclear technology. An examination of this paradox is called for. The hard truth is that neither the NPT nor the TPNW can achieve disarmament for the foreseeable future because it is clear that none of the nuclear-armed states are willing to reimagine a global system based on common security rather than on nuclear coercion, euphemistically called deterrence. We cannot leave our future survival to our national governments. Humanity must include all of us from all walks of life, wherever we live. As Mahatma Gandhi observed, quote, "The moral to be legitimately drawn from the supreme tragedy of the bomb is that it will not be destroyed by counterbombs, even as violence cannot be by counterviolence. Mankind has to get out of violence only through nonviolence. Hatred can only be overcome by love. Counter-hatred only increases the surface as well as the depth of hatred." And he explained how social transformation will come from the bottom up. Quote, "We have to make truth and nonviolence not matters for mere individual practice, but for practice by groups and communities and nations. Before general disarmament commences, some nation will have to dare to disarm herself and take large risks. The level of nonviolence in that nation, if that event happily comes to pass, will naturally have risen so high as to command universal respect. Her judgment will be unerring, her decisions firm, her capacity for heroic self-sacrifice will be great, and she will want to live as much for other nations as for herself," end quote. It's important to recall that coming on the heels of the many civil rights movements, the anti-Vietnam War, the anti-Vietnam War movement, the women's movement, the gay liberation movement, and the ecology movement, the massive anti-nuclear movement that arose in the 1980s was not single issue. As a strategy and a necessity this time around, let us work together to understand the common causes of our multifaceted crises as we work to build the massive, multi-issue, multi-generational, multi-racial, international moral fusion movement we'll need to overcome systemic violence, including the elimination of nuclear weapons, and build a peaceful, just, sustainable, and inclusive world. Tactically, I think we need to refocus our efforts at the local level in order to raise the visibility of nuclear risks to ordinary people and make them the subject of national discourse. Given the stakes, it is astonishing that nuclear weapons were barely mentioned during the 2020 presidential campaign. Going forward, we need to change that by working where we live to make nuclear weapons a local issue. And if there's time during the second session, I'd like to highlight a few examples of current local initiatives and campaigns. Bob mentioned some. I'd like to talk about Mayors for Peace and the Poor People's Campaign in particular. Finally, in anticipation of Dale's remarks, I want to offer a cautionary note on our approach to the war economy. I think we need to always keep in mind that militarism and the military budget are about more than just military spending and guns versus butter. We also need to pay attention to the purposes and interests that militarism serves and how perpetual war preparations underscore a culture of violence that runs from the top to the bottom of our society. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jackie. And now, Dale, Preston.
Okay. Hello. I'm very happy to be here, and you worked very hard to bring this together, and it's very nice to be on this panel with some illustrious folks that are seriously engaged in the battle to try to reduce the threat of nuclear weapons. As some people here know, my expertise is on the long-term effects of radiation, and I'm willing to talk about that or answer questions about that. But I think that we really need to talk about U.S. military spending. I think it's a cancer in our midst, and it's a cause of global instability, and it's something we need to think about. So it's a map of the world that shows military budgets. This is from the Swedish Peace Research Institute. This is for last year, and this is Department of Defense budget, essentially, the $800 billion in the U.S. The second largest is about $300 billion in China, and then every place else is considerably less than that. Russia, about $65 billion, which is about equal to the U.K. And France. And Japan, interestingly enough, which is not a nuclear power, but probably could be tomorrow if they so wished. And the next slide gives a history, sort of a, this is taken from the War Resisters League pamphlet in the back, but it shows sort of since 1948, U.S. military spending, and this is just the Department of Defense budget, over time, and you can see it did peak during the Afghan wars, Vietnam. It's been a steady increase over these 40 years. This is in constant dollars, 2022 dollars, so it's not, inflation is not a part of this. There was a real reduction after the war, and then since then it's been a rapid increase with the start of the Cold War. And the next slide shows U.S. defense. This is the actual request for the National Defense Authorization for this year. And it's the Department of Defense is about $730 billion of this on the left side. The current military, this is the cost we're spending this year for military equipment. But there's a lot of other departments in the government that do part of their work is related to military spending, including Department of Energy is a major player in that. And they handle nuclear weapons, modernization of nuclear weapons is one of their roles. But in addition to the current cost of the military, there is the cost of the past military, including the veterans' benefits that we're paying to people that suffered in the previous wars. And also, the larger fraction of that is the interest on the national debt that resulted from previous wars. So in total, that's about $700 billion, with the larger share being from the debt payment. These are very large numbers. It's sort of hard to comprehend. I think if we think about it in terms of how much money is being spent for each of the 330 plus million people in the U.S., if we just look at the Department of Defense, that's about $2,200 per person. If you look at the non-Department of Defense military, that's another $750 a person. So this current military costs are about $3,000 per person. If we look at the debt on the past wars, that's about $1,200 per person. And the VA benefits are about $900 per person. Much of the VA benefit goes for health care. And if we had a single-payer health care system, for example, we would all have those benefits. It would be a cost of the country. It probably could come out of some of this military spending. And I'd like to make a few comments on what we're spending some of this money on. And I'll also talk about some of the sort of wasteful programs and the way the money is being spent, and it makes a few other comments too. So Bob mentioned the nuclear weapons modernization program. The figure I had, he said $2 trillion over 30 years. I had a figure of $1.5 trillion, but somebody once said, you know, differences like that, they shouldn't turn into real money. And this includes new bombers, modernizing most nuclear weapons, including the large strategic weapons and tactical nuclear weapons, a whole new class of submarines with Trident III missiles, which are a new generation of multi warhead missiles, and a ground-based strategic deterrent, which I guess we no longer call Star Wars, but anyway. So that then the budget for that is $40 billion this coming year. And actually, I should also mention that these figures were before the recent additions. I think the Defense Department budget has increased by over 10%, and not much of that's not related to the war in Ukraine. And then if we talk about aircraft carrier groups. So in the world, the aircraft carrier groups consist of a large carrier and then a whole group of other ships and about 7,000 to 8,000 troops. The U.S. has 11 aircraft carriers with 9 active groups. These carriers, the current ones, cost $13 billion to make and have a development cost of about $30 billion. And there's one of these is in service, and 4 more announced, and 5 more planned. But the Navy already wants to move on to the next generation, even though they're committed to buying all these. So if we look at the rest of the world, Russia has no operational aircraft carrier group. They have. Their only large aircraft carrier was an accident happened in a shipyard, and they in 2017, and it had been in operation since 1995. It was taken out of operation after this incident in 2017, and at this point, it will not return to service any earlier than 2024. So we have 11 groups. They have the other countries that have them. China has 2 commissioned carriers, but only one of those is active. The other one is being designed, actually, so it won't be for many more years. UK has 1 group. France has 1. Italy has 1. India has 1. And Spain has 1, which is operated by Thailand. And then if we look at ballistic missile submarines, the U.S. has 14 Ohio-class submarines. Each one of these carries 24 missiles, but these are multi-warhead missiles, nuclear weapons. They can have up to 8 with 475 kilotons. This is about 30 times what was dropped on. Each one of those is about 30 times what was dropped on here, Hiroshima. We can have 14 with multiple 90-kiloton warheads or with an even larger multiple of 5 to 7 kiloton sort of so-called tactical like nuclear weapons, smaller nuclear weapons. It could have that many. Under the New START treaty, it's limited to 4 of these missiles. They can still have many, many warheads. But the New START treaty, as Bob said, is likely to be gone in 2 years, in which case I'm sure we would be putting 14 missiles on those boats. We also have 750 foreign bases in over 80 countries at a cost of operation of $100 billion a year. And this is 80% of all the foreign military bases in the world. So look at Russia, I think, has like 2, I think. And then the other thing I wanted to mention was greenhouse gas emissions. Bob also mentioned about that. It's the U.S. military is a huge producer of greenhouse gases. If it were a country, it would rank about 50th in the world just by itself. And it accounts for a fair fraction, but not overwhelming fraction of the U.S. Greenhouse gas emissions. Even without that, we would be the champion, I have a feeling. If we talk about this defense spending, I mean, there's a lot. We spend a huge amount of money, and I'm going to give a couple of examples. First of all, the F-35 fighter plane was developed the idea was developed by a joint service task force in the 1990s. The idea was you could have a basic platform that could be used by each branch of the military service, and they spent $1.7 trillion to date on developing this. It was intended as affordable, lightweight replacement for the 60-year-old Air Force F-16, the Navy A-10, and the Marine Corps Harrier and FA-18. In the current budget, there's over $2 billion for development and $7 billion for procurement. And the first variant was declared combat capable in 2017, but it was still plagued with over 800 identified problems. It's faster than expected engine wear. It has insufficient spare parts to ensure adequate flight time, and there are power module issues among many others. So it's not particularly useful. It also costs about twice as much to operate as the older planes. And because of the delays, they now have money in the budget to build the older plane still. So that's one example. The other, a littoral combat ship, a kind of large landing vessel. They spent over $30 billion over 20 years. And in 2017, the Navy said it was still trying to figure out the exact mission for these warships. Then they proposed spending $8 billion for making their ships reconfigurable before abandoning that idea. Then they thought just upgrades of $2 billion over 5 years. And now, this year, the Navy plans to decommission all 9 of the existing ships. And they say they're ineffective anti-submarine warfare systems, inability to perform any of the Navy's missions, constant breakdowns and structural failures in high-stress areas. So the plan is they're going to develop a new generation of these amazing boats. And the problem with these is there's a doctrine of, which I think is being abandoned, but a concurrency where they say they'll go out and propose, we need this, we don't know how it's going to work exactly, but you can develop and test it at the same time you're building production facilities. So there's inadequate testing, and then the needs change over time. So it's an incredibly inefficient system. If we also want to comment briefly on the military contractors this year, or I guess it was last year, actually. The largest contractors were Lockheed Martin with $73 billion in 1 year, Raytheon Technologies, $25 billion, General Dynamics, $22 billion, Boeing, $20 billion, and then there's some smaller ones. Humboldt County, we have some defense contractors, too. We aren't quite in that league, since between 2000 and 2020, there's been $91 million in contracts in Humboldt County. And in 2020, the figure I saw was $5 million. In 2019, it was about almost $12 million. Here, the largest recipients have been Wing Inflatables and then Kokatat, a company called McCullough Construction in Fortuna, and a company called Silicon Defense in Arcata. To put this budget in perspective, so we're spending $1.6 trillion on defense this year. The UN budget is about $3 billion for operations and $6 billion for, let's say, $7 billion for peacekeeping, so that's $10 billion. UNICEF is $7 billion, UN Development Program $5 billion, UNHCR, the Refugee High Commission for Refugees, is $3 billion, and the Population Fund is about $3 billion. So about $30 billion per year. If the U.S. were to pay all of that, that would be about $90 per citizen in the U.S. compared to $5,000 for defense. And we actually pay about 30%, so it's about $30 a person per year. So the question is, what can we do about it? You know, our Congress people, they all, Jared Huffman voted for the defense authorization bill, as did Feinstein and Padilla. And I wrote to Jared Huffman asking if he was going to support it. And he wrote me back and said, well, he doesn't like the idea of this large authorization, but you have to vote for it because it's the one thing they could do in this broken Congress where they can put amendments fairly freely into the defense, along with the defense authorization. Those amendments don't come out of the defense authorization if they have expenses with them. And he cited in particular that would benefit this area, the cannabis, a bill that would allow certain legitimate cannabis industries to use regular banks. That was one of them. And this year, I think they're talking about a wildlife protection bill. So one thing is, it would be very nice if we could pressure our congresspeople to sort of fight for separation of these little amendments, so then they could just have a straight up vote on that. That wouldn't solve the problem. I think it's really going to take people's action and major movements. But this, you know, if we want to do what we need to do in terms of healthcare or social services or climate change in particular, these numbers have to come down. And I think it's going to take huge action. And I think part of that action comes about realizing how much of the nuclear problem is on the U.S. You know, we're the major. I mean, we have technically fewer weapons than Russia, but we have much more sophisticated weaponry than Russia does. And so I think we need to discuss in the second hour, I hope there's an opportunity to any ideas people have of how we can increase awareness, get younger people than almost everybody in this room to be involved in these issues and aware of it. I think we are becoming more aware, at least of the threat of nuclear weapons because of what's going on in the Ukraine. But we need to be more aware of the costs of the U.S. military programs. And with that, I better stop and wrap up. And
thank you so much to our speakers. Before we take a short break, there's the PSA.
So there's been a nuclear attack. Don't ask me how or why, just know that the big one has hit. Okay, so what do we do? There are three important steps that I want you to remember. Step one, get inside fast. You, your friends, your family, get inside. And no, staying in the car is not an option. You need to get into a building and move away from the windows. Step two, stay inside. Shut all doors and windows. Have a basement? Head there. If you don't have one, get as far into the middle of the building as possible. If you were outside after the blast, get clean immediately. Remove and bag all outer clothing to keep radioactive dust or ash away from your body. Step three, stay tuned. Follow media for more information. Don't forget to sign up for Notify NYC for official alerts and updates. And don't go outside until officials say it's safe. All right, you've got this.
So this is a response by New York campaign to abolish nuclear weapons that was released a week after the former one we had to open up the session. It's been seen by well over a million people.
There you go, the internet's waking up. Oh. Thank you, Sudden Link. Not so Sudden Link.
Is that the first time you called?
Yeah. So there's been a nuclear attack. Don't ask me how or why, just know that the big one
has hit.
Wow.
Giving you time to digest the message.
Wi-Fi won't work with nuclear explosions.
Maybe you could download it during the break.
So this header shouldn't have been up there.
Okay, so what do we...
We should just bag it. It's too bad.
Yeah, we try.
Everybody on your phone? You can find this.
Yeah. Sorry about
really,
it.
It's really...
Could we do that, do you think? Could we reload it?
But no, they'll get better that they use computer
right,
so they don't have to write all the illegible.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's start with, there's kind of two questions that are related. And they are essentially, this is a good question too. They're all great, give me one second, because So with the current confrontation between the U.S. and Russia over the Ukraine, what would you suggest is the best way to avoid nuclear war? And kind of the related question there was, could you comment on the current threat of the use of tactical nuclear weapons in the Ukraine conflict?
Okay. Well, let me just say something about the second part of the question first. It was pointed out by a Russian analyst that I know, who's not a government person, who's sympathetic with the peace movement, that the Russian warnings have never used the word tactical. So that's an assumption. A difference between a tactical nuclear weapon and a strategic nuclear weapon is the tactical ones are smaller, launched for shorter distances, and they have lower yields. And that's just an assumption that's being made, and there are an awful lot of assumptions being made about and speculation about what Russian nuclear weapons use might or might not look like. So I don't think it's very useful to speculate about that. I do think it's very important to do everything we can to try to lower the temperature in terms of nuclear threats. And I mean, it's hard for us to do that as, you know, non-governmental actors. But one idea that I heard on a webinar today, Bob and I both heard, was a suggestion from a former U.S. Undersecretary of State to encourage nuclear negotiations between the United States and Russia, very limited scope, that wouldn't involve Ukraine, because there are all kinds of apparent roadblocks to having direct negotiations between Russia and Ukraine, or three-way negotiations. If it was just the U.S. has an interest in extending the START treaty, which will expire in 2026. Russia has said it's open to that, and they have started having some apparently preliminary negotiations on that. So perhaps that's something we could advocate, like let's get some nuclear negotiations going to lower the temperature, build some mutual, get them talking to each other again, and that might help to build some mutual, I don't know, confidence, trust, whatever, lower the threat. I want to mention one other initiative that we can participate in. This is just is being launched today. It's a petition expressing U.S. support from U.S. anti-war activists for Russian opposition to the war. And this isn't the exact language, but it says something like, as U.S. citizens, we actively oppose the illegal and inhumane U.S. military interventions in Vietnam, Iraq, and Afghanistan. Many of us suffered family division, social alienation, imprisonment, violence, and exile. We affirm our support for and solidarity with Russians who, despite the risk of harsh consequences, peacefully oppose and resist their government's military conscription and illegal, inhumane war of aggression in Ukraine. And this puts us firmly on a footing of being anti-war activists in solidarity with our Russian colleagues. And this is being supported by Russian anti-war activists in Russia and outside of Russia, and also anti-war activists in Ukraine. So I can make the link available to Jack, whoever, and make it available to your community.
Great. Do you
want to
say something?
Yeah, just to amplify what Jackie's saying, I guess we're talking about the same webinar from this morning. Yeah. In addition to moving forward on the START negotiations, which are strategic arms, as I referenced in my own talk, was the abrogation of the Intermediate Nuclear Forces Treaty by the Trump administration, which was a key disarmament move from the late 1980s. And in addition to talking about getting the START treaty talks going in, is having negotiations to restore the INF treaty and to incorporate in that dialogue China as well. And the thought about this is not just because of the strength that it can give to that treaty, which is very important in terms of that class of nuclear weapons, but if China is brought in, it's considered that that might help tamp down the move towards nuclear confrontation. Already, China and India, they've abstained from criticizing the Russian invasion. They've abstained from criticizing the annexation, but both China and India have been sending signals that they're not pleased with this invasion. So moving along this track can possibly help diffuse the situation as well.
I just make a comment. A week ago or even 10 days ago, I would have thought any Russian use of tactical or other nuclear weapons was pretty unlikely, and that situation does seem to change. But I still think the biggest threat is probably if conventional weapons are used that impact Zaporizhzhia and end up causing a nuclear accident, it wouldn't affect us particularly directly in this country, but it would impact a lot of people in the Ukraine and in Russia and in Western Europe. And I think that is a real danger that we're facing at this time.
Great. Well, that's not great, but thank you. Okay, so Dale, I think I'm going to ask you to start answering this one. It says, we support the military budget because every community has local defense contractors, vets, hospitals, and bases, big and small. We do not speak out about our local friends, so cannot speak to the national disgrace. How do I act morally when the sellout is also me? I just saved the big questions.
That's a really good question, and I know who asked it. It was a very moral person. And I don't have, I mean, we have to start acting. We have to start making people aware. I think just to create some awareness of this and to push back against even our representatives, for example, who consistently say they don't support this large amount of spending, but consistently vote for it because of these secondary issues. That would be a start. But I really think it's going to take a mass mobilization of people getting in the streets, and it's going to take not just, it is going to take younger people becoming aware of this and what it's costing them. And young people are very concerned about climate change. And I think if you tie these things together, maybe there's a chance. But something has to be done, because we're destroying this country and we're destroying the world by having this sort of threat that we create. I mean, we can talk about Russia and their nuclear weapons, but we're as guilty.
Yeah, I want to just offer a couple of thoughts on how we talk about security. The American people have the notion of national security being drummed into our heads day and night, 24/7, decade upon decade. And it's unquestioned. National security, well, if this is keeping us secure, then it's worth any amount, however much it costs. But it's not keeping us secure. It's endangering us. It's impoverishing us. And so I think we need to, the way we talk about this to people is help people understand that we need to redefine security in human terms. And I heard the head of the UN Development Program in the early 1990s at a speech that I can remember almost verbatim to this day because it was so illuminating. It was called "What Happened to the Peace Dividend?"
Yeah.
And he said, we need to fundamentally redefine security. We need to talk about security in terms of the individual, the security of the individual, in her home, in her family, in her environment, in her community, in her job, and so on. And this kind of security has to be regarded as universal and indivisible, and it cannot be brought about through guns, certainly, or violence, and certainly not by nuclear weapons. Now, if you offer that view to people who haven't thought about it, sometimes I've had the experience of it really changing their way of thinking about it. So I think that's an entry-level thing to do, is to start re-educating our population to make us, and it's related to a couple of other things, to help people understand that we are not our government, and that the Russians are not their government either. And in the use of our language, we need to talk about naming not Russia, not Mr. Russia, right? But the Russian government, or Putin and his circles, the Russian oligarchs, whatever, whichever government it happens to be. And I think that along the same lines, I don't think we should call it defense spending. I think we should call it military spending. Military spending, or even offensive military spending. The amount of it that's defensive is probably quite minuscule, right? And then finally, along those lines, again, these are small things, but I think they make a difference. Whenever you talk about the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, always say the U.S. atomic bombings. Because every year on August 6th and 9th, I'm really annoyed when I get these emails, which are, you know, commemorating the anniversary of the atomic bombings of Hiroshima. And I always write back in my subject line, anonymous atomic bombing reported, you know? But I think these are consciousness-raising things that are small, but if we think about how we use our language, I think it can make a difference. So again, redefine security in terms of human security and protection of the environment upon which all humanity relies.
I would only want to add, thinking back, it's 40 years since Ron Dellums wrote Defense Sense and was a leader of a movement for economic conversion, to actually be able to have an economic plan to give people good jobs so they're not blackmailed by, this is the only good job I can have, is building an F-16 or having a job with the Department of Energy. And, you know, in terms of what we're trying to think about, in terms of connecting the struggles against militarism with dealing with our climate crisis, it crosses that as well. I mean, we had a promise of a Green New Deal. We don't have to have communities blackmailed by the need to continue in extractive industries. Like, for example, we've been doing a lot of work on trying to stop fossil fuel extraction in Kern County, but you get the answer, well, you know, these are the best paying jobs my family has ever had. And certainly here in Humboldt County, this resonates through the history here in terms of extraction. There's a lot of money that's in the military budget that could pay for making those types of transformations, that people have good jobs and they're not destroying the planet in one way or another. The current Inflation Reduction Act is only a tenth of what was originally promised in the Build Back Better budgets by the Biden administration, and the loss of that 90% literally has starved us of the ability to do innovative programs, bring in alternative and sustainable energy in a parallel way that we're facing these terrible choices on the military budget.
So, given the issue of global warming secondary to carbon emissions, is there a role for nuclear power as a bridge energy source until renewable sources are better developed?
Say something?
Go down.
First of all, if you're going to talk about nuclear power as a bridge energy source, say that ignore the problems of waste. To build a nuclear power plant and get it operational in this country takes 25 to 30 years or more. And so the idea that it's a bridge is not a solution. And in addition, there still is not, even if you have them, there's nothing, no place to put the nuclear waste except right there on the facility. There probably won't be for any foreseeable future. And as we know, well know here in Humboldt Bay, we're sitting on, what was it, 6 tons or 60 tons? Like, but anyway, a lot of nuclear waste just stored right down here next to the bay, threatened by sea level rises, you'll hear more about soon. So I don't see nuclear energy as a bridge to anywhere. It's probably a bridge to nowhere. And the other problem with nuclear energy, say you build it, if there's an accident, the costs of that accident are huge, and maybe some of those costs are caused by social anxiety. I mean, people don't pay much attention to the psychological impacts of these things, and they, even after Fukushima, they don't. I mean, I had a suggestion. I was asked by some people in Japan what they should do, and I said they should set up a large-scale study comparing the tsunami victims and the people around Fukushima and what happens to their health. I mean, we sort of know, but that went away, and instead they did a thyroid monitoring program, which caused more anxiety than lessened anxiety. So I don't think nuclear power is much of an answer as a bridge to the future. I think we have to use less electricity. We need to develop renewable sources and other ways of coming up with power. And if it means we have less electricity for our luxurious lifestyle, that's a price we might have to pay.
Okay. I'll add some more reasons why this is a bridge to nowhere. It is true that production of nuclear energy is carbon neutral. However, building a nuclear power plant generates a lot of greenhouse gases, in part because it requires a lot of concrete. So over this 25-year period of their building it, they're emitting greenhouse gases. Secondly, it's a very, very centralized and expensive form of energy. And when I would just ask people to compare it to the idea of, is factory farming a bridge to the time when we get to a meatless future, you know? It just doesn't make any sense. It also is extremely secretive. It can't happen without government guarantees and loans, Price-Anderson Act. Maybe Bob wants to talk about that. It sets a bad example for other parts of the world who should be delegitimizing it, not re-legitimizing it, because any country that has a nuclear power plant has a bomb in its back pocket. And, of course, there is the waste thing. And now what we're seeing at Zaporizhzhia, for the first time in history, is the possibility of a nuclear power plant being used as a nuclear weapon, intentionally or by accident. And that's not the only nuclear power plant that's at risk in Ukraine right now. There are at least two others, including Chernobyl. And then, yes, the other thing is regarding Fukushima, there's another looming large-scale ecological catastrophe that we're not talking about much, but there's a plan now by the Japanese government and TEPCO to release a gazillion gallons of radioactive contaminated water that they're currently storing into the Pacific Ocean. This has been warned against by the UN. It's never been done in history. Studies haven't been done. And the effects of that potentially on marine life and on human life are as yet unknown. And that's supposed to start next year. So with that happening, with Zaporizhzhia happening, with all the other things that we've mentioned, it's a bridge to nowhere.
The only thing that I would add is that I think that both Dale and Jackie really covered the important safety issues, waste issues, and as well the economic alternatives, particularly we don't have to have such a hyper-consumptive society. But, you know, numerous experts, and we could provide you the information about this as well, have weighed in. If you're simply talking about the economic costs of energy, in addition to the fact that alternative sustainable energies are actually much more effective in dealing with the climate crisis sooner than the lead time you would need to build nuclear facilities, the cost of energy has plummeted so much over the last 20 years. So the work of Michael Schneider in Europe, Amory Lovins with the Rocky Mount Institute, Arjun Makajani, fossil free and nuclear free, are all really excellent works to just provide those answers on the economies alone. Jackie was referring to the Price-Anderson Act, whereby like the taxpayers on the hook in case there's a meltdown over a certain limit, that we would have to pay, much like people in Japan had to pay for the accidents, in the disasters in Fukushima. So there's really no reason anymore. The unfortunate thing is, you know, I'll reflect on people I work with, is that the power of the nuclear industry to put out this propaganda and work on those of us who really care about the climate crisis puts this out as a false promise. And unfortunately, again, buried, within the Inflation Reduction Act are massive subsidies to the nuclear power industry to do things like keep Diablo Canyon open. That's what Newsom is getting, the lure of the money for Newsom to kick over the Diablo Canyon plant. These are monies that are coming in to keep nuclear power plants, for example, in the Great Lakes, open decades beyond what their expiration should be, and put that entire region at the risk of a major disaster. So they're just the reasons for rejecting nuclear grow every day.
So I think these two go together and are a perfect opportunity to bring this wonderful session to a close. So I bought a TV at the start of the pandemic, and I watch the news, and I read the New York Times, and I read the New Yorker, and I see none of this information. So what's up with this? And then the other one I think is kind of, well, what if we created and appropriate PSAs for all the towns and cities to air on local TV stations.
Is that our last question?
there's a like what to do possibly But I mean, in terms of getting coverage for these issues, I mean, the all of the amazing information you've all shared tonight. It's true. It's
I heard there was through the Ollie program at Humboldt State on Matticut on Sunday, somebody talked about there's a sea level rise interest group that's set up locally, gets together and talks about what they can do, including making people aware. And maybe there's a need for a local sort of interest group on these issues of nuclear weapons and military spending and what we can do. So people thinking together and coming up with ideas. I mean, I don't have a bunch of ideas here, but I think we need to do something. And collectively, I think the ideas are not going to come out of sort of group action, I think.
So the media question, that's a really tough one, because there are bits and pieces that are reported in the New York Times, the Washington Post, other, you know, mainstream media sources. But there's also a whole lot of disinformation, partial information. And then we have all the alternative press, which is filled with both really valuable, good information and really terrible false information. So it's a real, you know, it's a real morass out there to try to figure out what's really going on. The idea of a PSA is interesting. And it might be something, you know, I don't know how, it would depend on, you know, I don't know how difficult it would be to get them placed or what the various media outlets might be. That would be something that certainly could be looked into locally. I was just trying to think of, you know, I can't think of like one media source that's totally useful, but there is the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists, which does carry a lot of current information and good analysis. And also, for some reason, Newsweek has been covering a lot of this stuff more than other. I don't know if they even have a paper version anymore, but they do have an online version, and they tend to cover this stuff more than some of the others. But no good answers really for you there.
Yeah, I mean, CNN has also covered stuff. I mean, we have leaders who more often than within Physicians for Social Responsibility, who more frequently than the past have been able to get coverage in CNN and, you know, even getting on Fox News interviews occasionally with the devil's advocate cross-examination thereof. But, you know, I think that question also gets into what's the transformation of the media these days and like you're saying, the degree of disinformation and the unfortunate fact that the concept of deterrence is sort of looked on almost like in this ahistorical way as like this is the reason we have these weapons and we need them. Although no one takes like a look even at Ukraine and say, well, if that were true, how is it that Russia can launch this brutal war while we're armed to the teeth with launch on warning and everything else? So these concepts of nuclear weapons as the peacekeeper or that they kept the peace, you know, since World War II really has to be deconstructed and criticized because on the one hand, there's been plenty of violence and wars in the world. So keeping the peace over since the end of World War II can be, you know, blown apart in terms of the truth of that. But the fact remains, just as it was at the dawn of the nuclear age, we're like moments from being blown away, if by miscalculation or by design. And, you know, if we look at the work of, say, Eric Schlosser in Command and Control and other people who've talked about these issues, there have been dozens of times where we've had come that close to an apocalypse because of a computer error or a flock of birds looks like an incoming attack. So the unfortunate thing is that when you do get coverage, it's superficial and it's a one-shot deal. And like a lot of other things, media is monopolized by the special interests. Don't want to have us see these truths. I mean, it's unfortunate we weren't able to show the response by New York campaign to abolish nuclear weapons, But in contrast to the usual media outlets, the fact that that very bright and adept work by New York Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons got millions of views, which, in, you know, from our experience, that's a lot more than we get from X, Y, and Z panel discussions or the occasional op-ed that we get in place. So that's a real thought, to be able to utilize that type of technology. I mean, if we could get that on TikTok or something like that and get a mass buzz on that, maybe that'll have much more of an impact, particularly for younger people, to be able to see that type of juxtaposition of, like, what the propaganda is and what the reality of a nuclear attack would be.
So do any of the speakers have a final last word they would like to say?
No? Okay. All right. I wanted to just briefly mention two initiatives that I think are worth supporting very much so, and I'll tell you why. First of all, Mayors for Peace, which was founded in 1982 at the second special session on disarmament at the United Nations during the height of the anti-nuclear movement, is led by the mayors of Hiroshima and Nagasaki and is working for a world without nuclear weapons, safe and resilient cities, and a culture of peace as essential components to achieve world peace. As of October 1st, Mayors for Peace has 8,213 member cities in 166 countries and regions, with 222 U.S. members, representing in total more than 1 billion people. And Mayors for Peace's next membership goal is to reach 10,000 member cities. So Eureka and Arcata have both adopted Back from the Brink resolutions, and neither Eureka's mayor nor Arcata's members are yet members of Mayors for Peace. So I already talked to Dave Meserve during the break about Arcata, but I really, you know, would encourage you, it should be pretty easy to get those two mayors to join, and any other mayors in the region. And I have a Mayors for Peace sort of information toolkit that I can provide to you. It just kind of breaks it down. The other one I want to talk about is the Poor People's Campaign, a national call for moral revival, which Bob mentioned and I mentioned. So before, exactly 1 year before Martin Luther King was assassinated, to the day, he said, King declared, "I'm convinced that if we're to get on the right side of the world revolution, we as a nation must undergo a radical revolution of values. We must rapidly begin the shift from a thing-oriented society to a person-oriented society. When machines and computers, profit motives, and property rights are considered more important than people, the giant triplets of racism, extreme materialism, and militarism are incapable of being conquered." So the Poor People's Campaign, a national call for moral revival, has picked up King's unfinished work, which was the Poor People's Campaign, the time he was killed, weaving the interlocking injustices of systemic racism, systemic poverty, environmental devastation, militarism, and the war economy, and a distorted moral narrative of religious nationalism, which blames poor people for being poor, into one moral fusion campaign. I used that word earlier. And the Poor People's Campaign takes on board fully our issues, what we've been talking about tonight. The Poor People's Campaign moral budget calls for cutting U.S. military spending by half, closing 60% of U.S. foreign military bases, ending the endless wars, and dismantling and eliminating nuclear weapons. With active organizations in about 40 states, the Poor People's Campaign is centering the voices of 140 million poor and low-wealth people and is being supported by a truly extraordinary range of constituencies, including labor unions, faith organizations, racial justice, anti-poverty, environmental, and peace groups, and is building political power by mobilizing, organizing, registering, and educating for a movement that votes. Now, that sounds like a bunch of jargon, but the bottom line is it's a growing, big, broad, multiracial, intergenerational, multi-faith, et cetera, organization. that has adopted this moral fusion idea, which means I can be working on my thing, but I have your back, and we're all working for the same things. So right now there's the emphasis is on the midterm election. The idea, the focus is on contacting poor and low wealth voters with a low propensity for voting, getting them to turn out based on the issues, not the candidates. And they've already done a study based on the last election, which shows that this strategy was instrumental in determining the outcome of some of the last races, particularly in Georgia. That's the best example. So I would really, there is an active California campaign, and I would really encourage people to look into and get involved with the California Poor People's Campaign, because it is a foot in the door to what is already starting to become a massive movement, which is what we're going to need to win on any of these issues. And you can just Google Poor People's Campaign, you'll find it.
So I would just add that there's something very specific that you can do too for the Poor People's Campaign, which right now they have text banks, and it's a really uplifting thing to be part of. They're very well organized, as Jackie was saying, and there's lots of, so when you're part of it, because I've been doing this, and lots of other folks have groups of people who come to their houses, you know, they kind of have like, it's like a local group, like folks might be here organized in a local group for different things, and then they make it like a house party, and everybody sits there and texts, because the text is outreach to people who have, in this case, it's obviously in states where it really matters to get people out to vote for this. So it's a really enriching thing to do to affect the midterms, which is really kind of an underlying thing that's hanging over our heads, where the nuclear weapon is under the table ticking and the midterms are here. It's a challenging time. So did you want to say something?
Just in closing, nothing to add to what our speakers have said, except I just wanted to personally just thank everyone here in the room for all your incredible organizing work over the years of the Golden Rule Project and Humboldt Veterans for Peace, and all your collegial organizations who've just done such inspiring work keeping these memories alive and keeping this organizing going. Thanks to Jack and everyone else on the organizing committee for these wonderful festivals. It's so great after the 2 years of COVID hiatus to be seeing you all again. So just such appreciation for the strength of this community effort.
Thank you, the panel, for a really stimulating
Oh.